touching on problems that are facing the industries. But when you look at our country, most of these things have nothing to do with the daily livelihood of the people. Mm-hmm. So I think it is steps in the right direction, because we need to get back, if not where we were, but to a better position, where whenever we are doing research, whenever a university is offering a course, it is not offering it for the purposes of making money. It is, the objective should be bridging the skills gap that are within our labor industry. Mm-hmm. So it should be synchronized so that it's very clear that the educational sector is responding to the needs in the market, and kind of do away with this commercial appetite,
right,
where universities are just offering courses, yet they do not even have the minimum threshold in terms of the technical facilities that are required for specific courses.
Mm-hmm.
So I think for me, Matiang'i is in the right direction. It should move with speed and make sure that the courses that offer particular degrees, those degrees are recognized all over the world, mm-hmm. not just in Kenya.
Right, and speaking of the commercialization of university education, because taking a look at these three universities, some of the issues that have been singled out by the Commission for University Education is the fact that some of them are offering programs that have not been accredited by the Commission for University Education. In some cases, it takes 9 months to complete an undergraduate course. And this is universities that are, you know, in our country. Caroline, we've had a lot of complaints of the fact that university graduates over the past few years are half-baked and not ready for the corporate sector. Your thoughts on what Matiang'i is doing so far?
It is important, first of all, thank you for having me on the show. It's important for us to streamline education, because every year we churn thousands of graduates. And gone are the days of our parents when someone graduated from university, you'd know they'd get a good job, they'd be a good quality citizen, and they'd produce to the system, to the economic growth, they'd be in the workplace. But now a lot of graduates, they want to get A's and honors in universities without even attending classes. And the saddest thing is some of our leaders, we see them even graduating with university papers, and stories are told of how they've never been to class, mm-hmm. people sat exams for them. And so I believe Matiang'i needs to return back the quality of education, especially among our young people. And if our graduates do go through proper education, they realize that they too can be job creators. Mm-hmm. Not everyone should be looking for a job. There is no economy, then even America in itself, with its 200 years, cannot uphold all the graduates to be able to be employed into the workplace.
Mm-hmm.
So graduates need to understand that they need to be innovators, you know. The universities also need to equip them to develop their talents. We have a lot of talented people, you know. For instance, in this country, we have a lot of engineers, but look at our roads. You know, we have a lot of doctors, but look at the health sector. So it is not just about graduating, but the quality of the young people that have graduated, the quality of education that they've earned, that will transform our nation and actually transform the youth of this nation.
Right. And even as we say that, should we really just only blame the graduates per se? Because at the end of the day, we have these universities that are out here offering shortcuts for these desperate young people who want to graduate as fast as possible, want to spend as little money as possible in obtaining that degree. I mean, Victor, the problem is a lot bigger than just the graduates looking for shortcuts.
Yeah, sure. First of all, I'm really grateful, and thank you for hosting me. This is my first show in KTN.
Welcome.
Just to be brief on the matters of the matters on education system in Kenya, the education system was rotten, mm-hmm. actually. If I'm allowed to use that word,
yeah.
It was rotten. But I must say I'm happy with the Cabinet Secretary Matiang'i for the good job he's doing. He's trying to streamline the education system in Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
How on earth would one do a course for 9 months and get a degree?
Mm-hmm. So that's a problem that needs to be addressed. But
yeah.
Even from this university saga and the saga over degrees, we've this week also seen the issue of credentials for political leaders and aspirants also coming out. Top of the mind, of course, is Mombasa Governor Hassan Ali Joho. And the bigger question that came out of this, other than the political power play, is whether good grades and academic credentials really translate into good leadership. Francis.
Yeah, I think let me be quick to demystify the notion that you cannot take 9 months or 1 year to get your degree, because it depends on where you're coming from. There are people who have, you know, gone, they have done certificates, they have done diplomas, they have done higher diplomas. So basically, normally what happens, you are allowed to present your credentials and you are given credit hours so that you are exempted from some things that you have already gone through. There are even institutions, even abroad, which even look at your expertise and your experience so that if they match up, and that's why always when you get to the papers, when they're advertising for positions, they say you are required to have this or an equivalent. No, the task has been to prove that equivalence. And I think that is where most people are misusing. But there is a possibility that you could have taken 9 months, but rightly so, because there are people who have passed through the long process. And by the way, I want to be quick to say, some of those people are very good in the market. The people who have passed through the long haul, which is the certificate, the craft certificate, the diploma, the higher diploma, they have been some of our best, you know, people in the industry out there, particularly not in the intellectual market, but in the actual industry where you are manufacturing and giving services. But I will also be quick in saying that the fact that you have an A does not necessarily interpret that you are a good leader. You could be having an A, but you are a poor leader. But you could also have an A, but you are a very good leader as well. So really, it is not the sole determinant as to whether you are a good leader. I know, for example, of somebody I for example, taught in Sunday school, who actually obtained a D. But today, he is a pilot. I don't want to say where, but I want to tell you, somehow he worked his way. Worked his way, and he actually got a scholarship. He went out there, and when he sat for his bachelor's, he was the best student in that class outside the country. He was given a scholarship to go to Europe to do masters. He was the best student out of the class. And he had students of A's and et cetera.
So these opportunities and good grades do not translate into good leadership.
But not necessarily.
What you're bringing up is another
issue. We should have a benchmark.
It's another issue that I'd like us to discuss. Yes. Whether everybody who gets that D and below has that equal opportunity or to also become a governor, to also become a pilot, like you're saying. But let's hear from Caroline for a minute. That same question. Do good grades really translate into good leadership?
First of all, I'd like to say only maybe 10% of Kenyans do get that A or that B plus or that A minus.
I mean, let's focus on just last year alone. Only 400 Kenyans got A's.
Which is like 0.0%, something percent. So I'd like to say there's no student or there's no young person or there's no one in life who has got a D on their forehead or a C on their forehead. It depends on what you want in life, the vision you have, you know. What are you, a go-getter person? So for me personally, regarding our leaders who have D's, or they say our president has a C, or which other person has a B, first of all, I'd like to say our grade does not define who we are, because we have strengths, and we do know that our 8-4-4 system sometimes does not remove every strength. It applauses those people who are good in sciences. If I'm good in maths, every teacher will applaud me. But if I'm good in literature and humanities, I'm at the back. So in life, we all have our strengths and our weaknesses. So maybe that person who got a D in leadership, maybe they're really good. But also it accounts to the quality of life that you want to get, what it is that you aim to get. A lot of our young people, they aim maybe to really get an A under all costs. But that A will never get you a job, because it was never genuine. You do not know the cost of that A. So I believe, as much as those students who have gotten C, D's and E's, and I'd like to tell young people to own it, to go and actually be honest to your employers about it and actually talk about your strengths rather than looking down at your weaknesses.
Right.
So that's what I'd like to tell them.
Yeah. And the question I was asking Francis earlier is, you know, whether everybody has really that equal opportunity. Victor, you're rather young, 23 years old, so you're probably still in school or just came from school. Like last year, only 141 Kenyans got A's, and we saw stakeholders in the education sector coming up in arms saying the marking was wrong. You have condemned thousands, hundreds of thousands of Kenyans who got a D and, you know, below to failure for the rest of their lives. So do you feel like we have those equal opportunities, that everybody who gets a D can make their way to whatever they want to be?
Yeah, first, the grade you get in school will not determine who you'll be in life. Life out here is, a message to the, my fellow youth. Mm-hmm. Life out here is not easy. And out here, the grade you got in school will not determine your life. What is important is you be smart. There's a difference between working hard and working smart. Mm-hmm. The life out here requires one to be smart.
Street smart.
Yeah,
street
and...
I just remembered a brief story. My grandmother, who only reached class 3, she's the director of a school, and it's like, it's one of the top performing school. In her own school, she has a Porsche meal, she has a biogas, so sometimes, and you see she never went to school, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes we need to understand, most of the time we need to understand as young people that a grade does not determine who you will be in life.
All right.
Yes. I just wanted to add something and say that unfortunately, the grades have been defining who people are, because you realize even from the grades of last year, as you allude, many of the people who got good grades are from the schools, the better schools, in terms of being equipped. And that emanates right from even primary school. Mm-hmm. People from private schools get higher grades because of the way the schools are equipped and the caliber of the teachers that they have. So you can see already, even if it is not stated as a policy, but it has been defining. So basically, coming back to your question, does it offer equal opportunity? The answer is no. It is totally skewed. It is exclusivist, because all the way, you go to Nairobi University, for example, and they say, and they have told us even before, and especially when the results came out, that almost 100% of the people who are taken in into medicine are the students who got A's. And we even got to know how some of those A's were acquired. Mm-hmm. So there is no way, because of that minimum threshold, the student with a C+ or with a B- had no opportunity to do medicine. So to that student who wanted to become a doctor, he cannot or she cannot because of the benchmark that is set. And yet it is only factor that is used to determine. I would wish that just like even if all of us had an A in Form 4 and we are applying for a job, normally we go in for an interview.
Right.
And it is the interview that is the greatest determinant. Mm-hmm. I would wish that even in taking up this medicine courses, these courses, there is another test that is taken by all the students so that over and above the grade you get, it is either confirmed that you have that level of IQ that is required for the purposes of that course. But unfortunately for now, everything is skewed, and I'm hoping that when Matiang'i is through with the alignment of these universities, he gets to the aspect of the grades, because we are getting people who become doctors which they had never wanted because they have the grade. And that is why sometimes we have the kind of production, the productivity we are having in the various industrial sectors, which is totally poor, because by virtue of grade, you become what somebody else should have become instead of yourself.
Right, what
so it is
expects.
Already skewed, it is exclusivist, and we are telling Matiang'i, speed up, out of what you have done, now get to this admission of the courses so that you get people in their best, the courses that they desire most, they have ever aspired, they have ever looked forward to becoming. That is the only way we are going to increase the productivity. That's why the only way we are going to have a bicycle produced in Kenya by the engineers. That's the only way we are, you know, going to have various things that are produced within this country. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Buy Kenya, build Kenya, yes. Right? So yes. Let's move on away from that and focus on another thing, making headlines. And that's on page 10 of the Standard this morning. Defiance by irrigation PS triggers major reshuffle. This also begins on the front page. And the headline there is why Uhuru reshuffled his principal secretaries. Now, as you know, 12 principal secretaries were reshuffled by President Uhuru Kenyatta. But what caught the eye of Kenyans is the fact that four of those principal secretaries have been adversely named in corruption scandals. Among them is now former health PS Nicholas Muraguri. And this has been very controversial. Let's begin with you, Victor. The very fact that four of them have been named in corruption scandals in their previous ministries, those scandals are yet to be investigated to completion and then have now been moved to other dockets. Your thoughts on that?
First of all, our country should come up with a mechanism on how to deal with corruption. If one is named on a scandal, he or she should carry his own cross.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think the president should crack the whip on those who are corrupt in this country.
Right. I mean, Caroline, this has elicited a lot of reactions as to the manner in which it was handled, as to the manner in which the president is also handling corruption. Was this the right way to do this?
I'd personally like to say, as we've seen in countries that are more developed than us, mm-hmm. if you have a corruption scandal, it is only right for you to step down. If you don't step down, it is up to Our Excellency to actually ask these people to step down to during investigations. Mm-hmm. And I actually believe that if truly our president does want to win these upcoming elections, I believe getting out people who are corrupt out of the system to give leeway for investigations to happen, for things to, because if I see, for instance, my colleague who's a PS, he's corrupt and stealing, and there's no mechanism to actually put him behind bars or to get evidence or anything. Mm-hmm. So now it has become rampant because there are no consequences to actions. So there are actually no consequences to corrupt people in this country. And we see a lot of them even actually running for political positions. And lo and behold, they may actually win these elections. Mm-hmm. But what is the message that we are telling our young people? That actually you can become a PS, you can become a CS, you can steal, and then life still will become beautiful mm-hmm. for
there
you.
Are no consequences.
And there are no consequences to the actions of corruption. And until we start behaving like countries like China, where if you dare steal a coin, you know, you're put behind bars, you can be executed, and then still we put in stringent measures to people who are corrupt, then even those institutions that we're talking about, our education system, our health system, our land system. I mean, it is shocking that, is it 900 billion has been put in the budget for the land ministry to be digitalized? Mm-hmm. 900 billion, a whole hooping, you know, why is it being digitalized? It's because there's so much corruption in the lands ministry. So until these people are put out of the system, actually they face the consequences, not just told to go home, but actually face the consequences, and other people with clean records put in place, then it'll send a clear-cut message across mm-hmm. the entire board mm-hmm. of leadership in mm-hmm. this
and
nation.
And Francis, of course, the argument for most of these who have been embroiled in corruption scandals and still running for political office or elective office or public office has been that there hasn't been any sufficient evidence to tie them down to their respective corruption cases. Is that, first of all, a substantive argument for them to still assume office? And then secondly, when it comes to the issue of Nicholas Muraguri, here we are, like Caroline has said, wanton corruption in the Ministry of Lands, and this is how we want, this is why we want it to be digitalized. But we are moving an individual suspected of corruption in one ministry and moving them to another ministry without that case having come to completion.
First of all, I would not want to speculate. The real and the dominant reason as to why the president decided mm-hmm. to do the reshuffle, because it is his prerogative as a president to be able to reshuffle the same people he appointed. And when they are signing their agreement with the employer, they say that they can be shifted to any ministry. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to speculate that. But I would also want to assert that no leader, no political leader, plans to lose an election. So you can be sure, this is alluding to what my sister said, that if the president wants to win the election, blah, 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 he has to do this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure he won't win. He cannot be planning to lose an election.
Right.
So, and I would imagine he's doing it in the best interest of his winning and in the best interest of his country. So, but I want to say, you know, this issue of when you are named, you stepped aside. You know, it depends who is naming you and for what reason, because Kenyans are very good in naming each other.
Mm-hmm. But you realize as soon as you're named, there's always that question of integrity among Kenyans themselves.
Yes, of course, it's not an issue of integrity. It's the aspect of reputation,
uh-huh.
the reputation that you create for the government. And to me, even the fact that, we are saying this one steps aside, we bring another one. Now, what is the measure of that other one who is coming in? Because I think it is bothering all of us. There is a problem in this country mm-hmm. in terms of integrity. And somebody once said that some people have never been corrupt because they have never gotten an opportunity to be corrupt. So I think we need to overhaul our mindset, our hearts, and our attitudes mm-hmm. towards public resources. But there are very few Kenyans who would stand and say, I have the integrity that is required.
Mm-hmm.
But that does not mean that we condone people with corruption practices. To me, even before you are sacked, you should be able to consider sacking yourself. And what we should do as a country, somebody said, the reason as to why you have so many traffic offenders is because the punishment is so insignificant that people think that they can get away with it. But if you made the penalty to be unproportional to the crime you have committed, where somebody would say, I think it's unfair, the punishment you are giving me is so high considered to the crime I've committed, that is the time Kenyans will stop breaking law. Where you actually fear breaking the law, where the Chinese, the punishment is to hang. So they don't even wait for the government to hang them, they hang themselves. So I think we need to consider what kind of punishment are we giving to people so that we are not arresting people to put in. What we should focus as a country is the deterrent measures. We need to make sure that we have enough deterrent measures so that people will be able to self-drive themselves into integrity as opposed to being forced to go to integrity.
Right. Yes. I mean, and Victor, you're running for the Kibra parliamentary seat. There's been a lot of, talk of corruption. So anybody who's running for elective seat, I would imagine, should have some sort of solution towards corruption. What do you think we should do? What direction should we go to solve this?
Just like I said earlier on, the government should come up with a mechanism of dealing with these corruption issues. First of all, when you've been named as a corrupt, let's say corrupt official, the first thing to do, you should just step down and pave way for the investigations. Because when you're still in power, you might use the powers to somehow to influence the ongoing investigations. So for me, one of the ways is to step down and you pave way for investigations.
And clearly it's not very easy to step down because nobody ever seems to want to do it. But let's move away from that for a second, even as we wind up with the Standard. Page 24 of the Standard, Mrs. Choice 2017, and the headline here is, "It's my time to eat," says a top witch doctor. And this is an interesting one. See, his name is Quick Kinyamasio. This is a witch doctor in Kitui County. He says he's been practicing witchcraft for 20 years and that during elective season, or the election period rather, business is a lot better because politicians are flocking to him to ensure that they can retain their seats, or aspirants flocking to him to ensure that they can win their seats. And I want to put this together with the issue of buying votes, which is also on the Standard this morning, and how effective vote buying really is in securing the final vote at the electorate. Let's begin with you, Francis. All this hullabaloo of going to the witch doctors and buying votes, where does it stop with politicians?
Well, it basically shows how naive we are. We call ourselves 80-90% Christians. And of course, even the 10 remaining, you have other, you know, our brothers and sisters from other religions. So, I mean, it amounts to the same thing I said, that we need to make these punishments that scary. We need to make them scary. Even in religious institutions, if you go to a certain religious platform and they get to know that you go to witch doctors, or the occults or whatever, wherever you go, to be able to, you know, influence who you are to become in life, that is a person who should not be given space in society at all. And it's illegal to practice witchcraft. So I wonder why that man is not in by now, because he should have been put in. Although perhaps the people to put him in will fear being bewitched. So it's a circus of the whole thing. But it's unfortunate, it's happening, as you have rightly said. You know, they say in Mombasa, wherever these destinations of witchcraft, they are getting booming business during campaign seasons. But it's also the high time, for Kenyans. And they take the lassos, the kangas. These are the same things that Kenyans are brought and they tie. And my understanding is that when you tie them, around your waist, on your head, they influence your thinking and all these kind of things.
Right.
And witchcraft is real, by the way, but it is not the superpower. If people want to trust God, they can actually trust God to overcome those kind of powers. But if you don't, they will influence you. They will take your money. They take that money to the witch guys. They will administer their witch to that money and they will come and give you the money. So it's upon Kenyans to determine, are we going to take this money for tomorrow only, or are we going to take the good leadership that we won for posterity?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it is upon every Kenyans to think. We are producing 60,000 graduates every year plus, every year. Yet, the companies that have been employing Kenyans have remained the same for the last 30 years. Mm-hmm. Instead, actually, some of them have closed up. So it's upon Kenyans to think of a leadership transition that is able to be innovative and creative, expand opportunities for this country,
mm-hmm.
leave people's money aside, because their money is their money. And even if you, you know, you use the criteria of who has money to elect, that money will never turn out to be yours.
Right.
So you better be focused, you better admit, like what Caroline said, you admit your status, and then you focus forward, but do not exchange, don't sell your birthright with things that are not long-lasting. And voter bribery, it's there, but what saddens me is the fact that there is a giver and there is a recipient
mm-hmm.
of that money.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody is willing to take 200 shillings and sell that vote without knowing that vote, in retrospect to the leader to be elected, determines the future of your kid.
Mm-hmm.
So the moment you have taken the 200 and used it to determine who to vote for, you are basically selling the birthright of your kid.
Right, and the issue here is that we have the giver and we have the recipient. This is what we're talking about, Caroline. In terms of voter bribery, you're running for the Kajiado Senate seat, and it's almost public perception now that you cannot run for a political seat without bribing your voters. Is this what's happening in Kajiado?
First of all, what I'd like to say is that as a nation, we need to invest in civic and voter education, especially at the grassroots level. A lot of the people, for instance, in my area, Kajiado, you know, the top people will campaign with choppers, and especially when they hear you're vying for Senate, they believe that you actually must have a lot of money. What I'd like to tell my people in Kajiado and Kenya at large, the minute that I spend a lot of money, there is no Kenyan who has got monopoly for so much money to do campaigns. They have gotten that money through some way, some deal, some loan. There is a way that they have gotten access to such large, huge amounts of money. And immediately they enter office, they must pay their loans that they've gotten that money. They must pay their debtors, their debt. They must be able to pay back the deals that they have done. And that way, for the first 2-3 years, you will not see the person who you voted in, because they are busy trying to replace or to repay back the money.
Mm-hmm.
So the minute campaign money goes so quickly. You think you've collected 100 shillings. But if I was to give 100 shillings to all my 400,000 voters, you know, that's, I have spent hundreds of millions. And when I enter office, I must pay back that money. And that is why you see service delivery in our counties is so low. Because if I bought your vote, then I don't owe you anything.
Mm-hmm.
So people must understand that you must put in leaders based on their past experience, not their new manifesto, what it is that they have done in your community, you know, the heart for humanity, the heart for the people, and the vision that they have for people, especially young people. You know, young people in this nation are not a constituency. Whenever you see, for instance, politicians wanting to reach out to people, they'll reach out to Maendeleo Wanawake, because, you know, women are kind of united,
mm-hmm.
but the youth are not united. They give the voter to the highest bidder. And until the young people of this nation wake up and stop selling their votes, then when these leaders enter into place, then maybe we'll begin seeing the innovation, the job creation, because these leaders will actually give service delivery and not sell their vote.
Right, and yeah. I totally agree with what you say, because all elections are transactions in one way or the other.
Yes.
You trade your vote for something you expect, better roads, better schools, better infrastructure. But when a politician comes and gives you money in exchange for the vote, then the transaction is done.
It's complete.
They really owe you absolutely nothing. Victor, with the Kibra constituency, do you have youth who expect you to dish out money before you address a rally?
First and foremost, I want to agree with my sister here. The IBC, with the budget they were allocated, were 4.2 billion. With the budget they allocated, I think they should really invest in civic education.
Mm-hmm.
They should teach both the young and the old the importance of participating in the elections and the importance of their votes.
Mm-hmm.
First, I don't see a need, the need where like a politicians come and give you 200 shillings in exchange of your vote.
Mm-hmm.
After that, it'll be nowhere to be seen.
Right.
The people, the voters should vote in a person whom they know they'll champion for service delivery.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Right.
Yeah. Personal Personally, in Kibra, I must say it's okay. People they've started to learn. Now people like that old age where when a politician comes and expects money is long gone.
Mm-hmm. So it's no longer all right. Although many politicians say that it's still rampant, Francis.
Yeah, I want to add another dimension to this bribery. You know, even aspirants are being bought to align themselves to certain candidates. So even as much as we are talking about bribery, it's rampant. Mm-hmm. You know, you see people lining up, you know, behind a certain candidate. I mean, they have been bribed. I don't mean all of them, but a good chunk of them, they are following a certain candidate because that candidate can finance their campaigns. Uh-huh. It's not based on any ideology. It's the fact that this guy can be able to finance my campaigns, or he has actually or she has actually bought them to align to that so that they can be seen to be having more supporters. Eh? So it's not just the public that you can be able to blame. The whole thing is a sickness with our society. And it's unfortunate that the fact that people have been informed, somebody said that head knowledge alone cannot help you transform. Mm-hmm. You could be having the knowledge in the head. The fact that you know smoking kills does not stop many people. Actually, many people who understand that are chain smokers. Mm-hmm. Yet they know smoking kills. So head knowledge alone cannot transform a human being. Mm-hmm. So I think beside the civic education, we need to look for this super mechanism, this super answer to this problem that we are having in this country. And I think for me, it's banning totally. Anybody who has been caught with voter bribery, be it a candidate, be it the Wananchi themselves, we need to come up with rules that sounds crazy, revolutionary rules. Mm-hmm. That make people fear doing some of these wrong things. And it is the only way that we can be able to be assured that we are on the right track as a country. Otherwise, we'll educate people, but we know we have educated people who have not transformed merely because they have the knowledge. Mm-hmm. We have leaders who are accusing of, you know, the voters of receiving bribes, yet the aspirants are receiving bribes from the top aspirants to be able to follow them. Mm-hmm. So it's a society that needs prayers.
Right, it's very deep-rooted, clearly.
Yeah. Another thing is that the political parties. Uh-huh. Political parties also have a responsibility not to necessarily support the candidate with the highest amount of money. For years, we have seen political parties rally behind a certain candidate because they are wealthy, because they are prominent. And until political parties start rallying behind a youth who has that ideology, mm-hmm. who has that capability, who has that vision, who has that heart for the people, that woman, she may not have the chopper or the money or everything else, but until political parties, because political parties have a responsibility. Like, I am in Jubilee Party, and I do know they could be having maybe certain candidates. Okay, they say that they don't have preferred candidates, but we are waiting to see that actually on the ground, mm-hmm. whether they will rally behind certain candidates or will they give an equal platform to everyone.
Mm-hmm. And of course, yes. That is the headache everybody is waiting to see how that's going to play out, especially after April. But let's focus on some of the top stories that have been taking place this week. And one of them, of course, on Thursday was the budget statement read by Treasury CS Henry Rotich. And Kenyans had a lot of expectations, this being the last budget before the election, a platform for the Jubilee administration to sort of fulfill the promises that it is yet to fulfill. Let's begin with you, Victor. Did the budget fulfill your expectations?
Yeah, first of all, I must say I'm happy with the budget. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because if you look at the amount for the budget, it's higher, meaning they'll have that, how do I put it? When you look at the amount of the budget is higher, mm-hmm. so meaning they'll work on infrastructure, things like roads, you get. Mm-hmm. And then as a youth, I'm also happy the amount that was allocated was 18 billion. I believe through that, and it's my plea, the government to revive the NYS from other towns that had the program was shut down. And again, if you look at the money that are allocated in health, education, and for the infrastructures like roads and last mile.
Mm-hmm.
It tells you the government is still going to do a lot. Take an example of health. The amount they allocated that will cater for the free maternal services, which that told Kenyans, and again for the free primary education, free examination fee.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so as a Kenyan, I must say I'm happy for
you're
the
budget. But Kenyans are still complaining of the very high cost of living. The government has still promised it's not going to impose any higher taxes on Kenyans, but Kenyans are still feeling the heat of that. I mean, Caroline, did this budget address the needs of the common mwananchi, really, considering especially that it comes 2 months before the election?
Okay, the total amount of budget is 2.63 compared to last year where it was 2.2 trillion.
Right.
And one of the things that the common mwananchi is happy about is that maize has been
zero rated
and bread, white flour, the main things, but it is only for 4 months.
Mm-hmm.
And what I would like to say is I'm happy to see that the elderly are being cared for. Everyone who's over 70 years will be getting 16,000. And and plus NHIF,
mm-hmm.
and also there is money for me, what I'm really happy about is ICT money that is going to be put into schools and schools all around the area, and
mm-hmm.
also money for rural electrification, because I believe the way forward for this nation is through ICT, and a lot of it has been invested, especially into the young people at every level of education. And another thing also is subsidies for fertilizers for farmers. And a lot of money has also been put into modernization of agriculture and irrigation projects. And also, it's also good to see that RiverTex, a lot of money has been, billions has been put back. Actually, it's millions has been put into RiverTex,
mm-hmm.
and to modernize it. And a lot of these industries where a lot of young people, employment had stopped for them, because these industries had been put to sleep. I see KCC has been given 100 million now to be called New KCC.
Mm-hmm.
So there'll be a lot of, let us believe that there'll be a lot of job opportunities with all these industries being opened up and ICTs being opened up. And also they've invested billions actually into education system in terms of innovation and science. So I believe Kenyans in the long run, as we go along. The only concern I have is that there's a deficit of 524 billion.
Mm-hmm.
So now this has to be borrowed from external and domestic,
right,
and through
just
public,
adding on to
yeah.
the public debt,
yes.
That the country the, has.
Yeah,
right.
So, yeah.
Francis, yeah. Your thoughts? Yes, Victor.
Mm-hmm. I must congratulate the government for the amount they had allocated for the old 70 years and above.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was perfect, because you know it will make the life expectancy to be high, because
mm-hmm.
you find that when a person is old, is aged, he'll not have that energy to work, and so maybe he'll be having a bigger family, so you'll get that this person will be stressed on how to maintain the family, on how to feed the family. But through that money channeled to them, at least they'll manage to,
you know, have a better life and maintain
the family. Again, the deficit is around 600. It's
524 billion.
Mm-hmm.
600 billion. I think the government can source it from either International Monetary Fund, or even from just within Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's why they've introduced the treasury bonds, people to invest in the treasury bonds,
right? So
at least to narrow the gap.
They've cried quite a few, but Kenyans are still very skeptical about the high debt that we have. But Francis, you have something to add to that?
I like being positive in life. First of all, it's very important to be optimistic. That's the only way you can be able to assure yourselves
mm-hmm.
of being there tomorrow. So I don't think I have any issues with the budget, but you know they say that the food is in the eating.
Mm-hmm.
Eh? So it's one thing to read the budget. And as you have heard many commentators, they have said, the aspect of monitoring and enforcement is a big challenge. Mm-hmm. And I like the fact that that talk is now happening, even within the government itself, because it's not the first time we are zero rating on some certain products,
right,
with the hope that the benefits will be able to trickle down to the local mwananchi. I remember some years back, the reinforcement bars, the ones which are for construction, was zero rated. And it was expected that the prices for the same would go down so that the cost of construction can go down. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you there was zero impact on the ground. So it was basically the business person who was enjoying the benefit as opposed to the intended person. So what is very critical is the enforcement and the monitoring to ensure that these benefits are actually trickled down to the person who was intended. That person who is buying the 2 kilogram packets of unga taking home. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it can easily go to the wrong people. So I think Kenyans, they are entitled to the complaint. But I think the responsibility of the government, as the talk is going around now, is to ensure that this time round, they will follow it up to ensure that the benefit is accrued to the right people. Mm-hmm. And they should also look not just at the unga in the supermarket. Because if the price of maize does not change, you are not likely to expect the unga at the shelf to change, because unga is from maize. So if the maize remains constant, the end results cannot change. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to synchronize these things and exactly understand how they work. Otherwise, you cannot treat a sickness from the top.
All right.
And then you expect the healing to be felt, because where the sickness is coming from is still producing the germs, mm-hmm, that are actually feeding into it. And I want to say that, of course, The budget is 2.6 trillion. It is projected that KRI will be able to collect 1.2. So the deficit is almost 1.5, mm-hmm, yeah, 1.5 billion. And I have one problem. For example, I saw that the 18.3 billion for the youth. You know, we have in the past had money. I put aside for the youth, put aside for the women, put aside for Uwezo Fund. But if you go down to the grassroots to find out who are the real beneficiaries, the intended and the projected impact by the government has actually not been felt. And that's why I love that this idea of monitoring and doing a follow-up. My suggestion would be, we have so many fragmented funding systems in this country. And the more the fragments, the less the impact. Mm-hmm. I think we need to consolidate all these funds, because that's what they have done in the Asian Tigers. They have consolidated these funds, perhaps to a constituency level or the smallest unit of our administrative or political framework, so that you start monitoring from there. For example, I was looking at the youth fund, which is 18.3. Mm-hmm. And I was looking, if you divide it by the 290 constituencies, it is 64 million per constituency. If you avail 64 million in the constituency, even if you are to lend to each youth group about half a million, as opposed to the 5,000 which they are being given, that is basically 128 youth groups. I am telling you, if we did that in one financial year, it will be felt. Some constituencies are too small, they'll be felt. Mm-hmm. And half a million is enough to generate some several elements of jobs,
right,
like 5, 6.
Right.
So I think, to me, we need to stop relooking at things from the global perspective of the national. And that aspect, even we need to change what are the elements of devolution, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, so that it is not monitoring these governors and all that, you know, with the devolution ministry. Why doesn't the government consolidate all these funds, take them right to the smallest units, and let the devolution ministry now, through the national government, monitor the impact and force to make sure the impact is felt where it is required?
Because that was another next point of conversation.
Yeah.
Devolution, of course, is a key area of the new constitution. And as much as governors and county governments are asking for more funds, we've had the Auditor General come out and say the rate of corruption is highest at the county level. So in terms of consolidation, in terms of monitoring the monies that are sent to the counties, what frameworks then would need to be put in place? Because there seems to be no means of really monitoring money in the counties.
Dare to tie that to my, because I raised it up.
All right, then Karen, come next.
I want to say that, you see, before the devolution, before Constitution in 2010, mm-hmm, there were elements of devolution, like CDF was an element of devolution, mm-hmm, where money was, you know, it was like piloting to see what little money can do at the constituency level. And I would want to say that The fact that some counties are mismanaging funds mm-hmm. is no reason to deny the counties their entitlement. And I'm not saying they're being denied. So the fact that some counties are being corrupt is no reason for the government to stop implementing its program. Mm-hmm. Because when you are corrupt, you go to jail or you are terminated. The government has a mechanism even actually of, you know, canceling the entire government of a county. Mm-hmm. That is there in law where it can be dissolved and new elections can be held. So the problem is we have so many papers in Kenya which are very good. But in terms of implementation, because if the county government has really become corrupt, a member of parliament just from a county can actually table a motion in parliament and that investigation can be done. And if it is found to be true, the National Assembly with arrangement with the president office can actually dissolve a county government mm-hmm. to prepare for a new election if they are found to be guilty. But we have not had any single motion like that one.
That has
so
been done.
It, to me, it is double standards for MPs to claim that the county's government are corrupt, yet we have seen none of them table a motion to dissolve a county government because it has become absolutely corrupt.
Let's hear from Carolyn for a minute.
The work of the senator is to actually make devolution work at the county mm-hmm. level mm-hmm. through the Senate. And one of the things, their role is oversight. And this is oversight of all the expenditure of the county. So until we have senators who can actually call out on transparency to the governors, to the MCAs, we will never see. For instance, I come from a county where there has been issues, you know, in Kajiado County in how our expenditure has been used. But other counties, it's even been worse. You know, we all know the Wilbaro saga, but is there been evidence? Have they been called by anti-corruption? So until we have senators who actually call out for transparency in oversight of expenditure of mm-hmm. these funds, and until there is a framework to actually monitor how these funds are used in the county, because if you check, most counties get billions of shillings. Are they accountable to every penny? Are the wananchi, do they know how much is being spent and on what? Are they being involved? Is the whole system transparent? Are the people being involved in the budgeting process? And if they're involved, leave alone even in the budgeting process, in the procurement process, is it transparent? A lot of money is getting lost in and there, but till to date, we have not seen any governor who has been put on the newspapers, who has been called out that they've been corrupt, that they've actually been to a court and actually been followed up by the court process. Mm-hmm. And until the legal process actually stands up, and until senators begin to actually deliver and actually provide that oversight and that transparency that is needed at the county level, we will continue seeing in the new county government, still money being embezzled. Mm-hmm. I believe that there are some certain areas, for instance, in my county, yes, there are some areas, for instance, like water and health, where money can be added, but they must be accountable for the budget for health and water in the previous year. Did they use it in a transparent manner? And if you're asking money, it's specifically for what? And how do you exactly want to use this
right.
money?
Now, like you yeah. rightfully said, I'll come to you in a minute, Victor, like you rightfully said, the role of the Senate is oversight.
Yes.
And still, we've seen so much corruption in the counties. It is for that same reason that Kenyans have now been asking for the dissolution of Senate. Kenyans are asking, do we really need the Senate? In your own view, running for the Senate seat in Kajiado, has the Senate, the pioneer Senate, so to speak, really fulfilled their mandate?
I personally would say that the sitting senator has done his 5 years, mm-hmm. and the people of Kajiado clearly have seen how he has delivered. I am asking for all Kenyans to actually vote in senators who will deliver. Mm-hmm. But until you keep on voting in the same people because they are wealthy and they are powerful, you will see zero results.
But your thoughts on the Senate as a whole, the Senate House, and its delivery for the past 5 years?
I believe the Senate has got one of the most logic. If you see the debates of the Senate, they are logic, they are less temperamental, they stick to the issues, they focus on matters. So I believe that the Senate is very necessary mm-hmm. because the role is actually to be the oversight of the county governments. Mm-hmm. And if there is no oversight for the expenditure, who will be able to put the county governments in check? I believe the Senate actually have a big mandate, and Kenyans need to understand the role of the Senate. Right, I believe part of it is that Kenyans don't exactly understand the role of the Senate in terms of legislation, oversight.
Has there been a single senator that has called out their governor in terms of corruption, really put them, you know, take them to account in terms of what they've done? Has there been a senator that Kenyans can look to and say, yes, that is what a senator should do?
I'm hoping that I'll be the first in my county. I am speaking for my county. I believe other people can speak for their county, but I want to be able to deliver for my county in a way that people know that I have actually fought for the transparency of the $4 billion that we get from our national government.
Just before I come to you, Francis, just before I come to you, Victor had something to add to that.
The budget still, there's this debate of the betting farms being taxed for about 50%. Yeah. For me, I think the government was right on that. Because, you know, just let me start it from at this point. The betting farms has really destroyed the values of our youth. Mm-hmm. Most of them are lazy. We miss the world where youths were hardworking. Since the introduction of the betting sites, the gambling that is, it has really made our youth to be lazy. Then those guys, the betting farms, they make a lot of money.
All right, okay. All right, gentlemen, we're out of time. Let's just have your final word, Francis.
So, Michelle, I want to say that it's good to be fair where people have performed. Mm-hmm. I think if there is a house that has been in loggerheads with the county government, it's basically the same.
Right.
So they have criticized, they have brought the governors to court, they have brought them before Senate, they have brought them before Parliament. But we have one major problem. Mm-hmm. The framework within which the senators can give oversight to the county government is not there. You remember they wanted to start a project management committee, which is supposed to be chaired by the senator within the counties,
right,
and it did not see the light of the day. So as much as you can have good senators, but without frameworks where they can be able to operate, you basically have nothing to be able to do.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, we need to accept this framework, because we should not allow the governor to be the judge and the jury. That is the one who is implementing the project, but he's also the one who is oversighting upon himself.
Mm-hmm.
So the oversight role for the senator at the county level as of now is only ceremonial,
mm-hmm,
because he has not been given the framework and the teeth to be able to do that. But in terms of being able to do this job within Parliament, I think I can say that they have tried. And that is how some of them are giving themselves to be governors. I don't know whether they do better or not without the same framework. But to me, what Kenyans should yearn for is to make sure there is framework, and the fact that the senator should actually have some oversight role at the county level, but they should not be involved in the implementation. But we should also make sure there are no parallel development projects,
mm-hmm,
within the counties, because it is happening. MPs are having parallel government.
Right.
Governor is having his own. The conflict yet. Even the opposition MPs are part of government.
All right, so it all needs to be synchronized. All right, gentlemen, we're out of time. Thank you so much for joining us. We've been speaking to Francis Parsimei, who is the Kajiado North parliamentary seat aspirant. We also have Caroline Shege, Senate aspirant to Kajiado County, as well as Ayugi Victor, who is the Kibra parliamentary aspirant. Many thanks for joining us on Weekend Express, lady and gentlemen. And that conversation brings us to a close on the show. We thank you for watching. My name is Michelle Ngele. Have a good morning. I'll be back at the top of the hour with more.